Hi, everyone. Welcome back. I'm Michael Sandler, your host on Inspire Nation. If you've ever wanted more success, happiness, and peace in your life, then do we have the Urban Monk Show for you. Today, I'll be talking with Dr. Pedram Shojai, qigong master, master herbalist, and doctor of oriental medicine. He's also the host of the Health Bridge and the Urban Monk podcast, and the author of an amazing owner's manual to living a more balanced, in-sync life, The Urban Monk. And that's just what I want to talk with him about today, about how to use Eastern wisdom and modern hacks to stop time and find success, happiness, and peace. That plus we'll talk about a monthly vow of silence, fasting in Waimea, running in the dark, why you don't need Oakley Iridiums, the power of bouldering, why hibernation's a must, and why in the world, above all else, you want to do kung fu stances while standing at your desk. So welcome to the show, Pedram. Are you ready to shine?
Ready to shine. Hello.
Hello, and a mighty woohoo!
Yeah, man. Always ready to shine.
Actually, awesome.
Just got back from a ski trip and just huffing mountain air and having really, really good time using the body the way it's designed to be used, which is really a lot of exertion and, you know, things that you don't get sitting at a desk all the time. So, yeah, I'm a big fan of movement.
Was that a ski area in California?
No, I was actually in Boulder, Colorado for a week doing an audio program and then just worked hard to finish fast and went to Vail for 3 days. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, man, Vail, Colorado is one of the best ski resorts in the world. It was great.
Absolutely. I lived in, well, I was a front ranger for over 25 years, Boulder for 7 of those years. And Vail was just a mountain that you could just explore and explore and explore.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just, it's monstrous. Like you won't get bored. If you're bored at Vail, then, you know, you got other problems. It's just so immense.
Awesome. So let's go from there. I want to take us back in time a little bit, kind of put us in a capsule. We'll do the Wayne's World. Take us back. Can you tell us about being pre-med UCLA and how you tripped across Tai Chi?
Yeah. So I was in the martial arts as a kid. I mean, I always, you know, my parents knew that, you know, either they channeled that monkey or, you know, he was going to like, you know, make trouble. Mm-hmm. And so I was always in the martial arts and always wanted to be a Jedi. You know, I didn't think that the Jedi thing was very practical, given that it was fictional until I realized it wasn't. I was studying hard. I mean, I was ranked number one in my high school, went straight to UCLA. I'm off to be a medical doctor. And so I'm surrounded by a bunch of really, really miserable people in the you know, pre-med slash medical department. I'm interning at this pain medicine center. And, you know, there just wasn't that much hope. There wasn't that much solution other than morphine for what we were doing. And on the other side of that spectrum, on the other side of campus, you know, I found a Tai Chi teacher and we're out there just, you know, feeling chi and breathing in sunlight and doing all sorts of really cool things. And,
yeah.
And you could feel it, man. You know, you're like, whoa, wow, I feel great. This is something. And then the marked contrast between that something and the other something that I was pursuing, you know, in medicine, just became more and more apparent that it was not filled with life. There was no vitality in that path. And that was it. I was just like, hey, listen, I you know, there's something to this Tai Chi stuff and I got to know. And then I went and found a Kung Fu master and went down a slippery slope from there.
So what did the slippery slope look like? Because you ended up with Taoism, Kung Fu, Qigong, the Himalayas.
Yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, the first slippery slope starts with the slippery step, right? Mm-hmm. Just, you know, you're sliding from there. So I actually... I'll get into the full story. Why not? So I was a bit confused because, mm-hmm. you know, here I am banging away trying to, you know, fulfill the role that I was, you know, fulfilling as a young kind of college student. You work hard, you get to a place and, you know, at the ripe age of 18, you're supposed to declare your major and tell the world what you're going to be for the rest of your life. And you don't even know who you are. Right. And so I decide I don't want to do medicine. And so I'm, you know, kind of stumbling around, the library I was studying for something, trying to figure out like what, you know, so now what the hell, right? You know, and so do I just declare another major and pretend to be a lawyer guy or an engineer guy? And you know, what I'm really doing is becoming more and more aware of this internal universe, but no one pays for that. And so, you know, going through the kind of reconciliation of how I feel and what I think I ought to do, mm-hmm. I asked God, actually. I was like, yo, look, dude, if you're you're up there, if you're out there, what, you know, send me a clue. Like, what am I supposed to do at this stage? I'm really confused. And this normally doesn't happen. A book fell out of a bookshelf.
I love it.
Right? 25 feet in front of me. And I'm just like, oh, come on, shut up. Right? So I walk and I'm like looking through like the shelf as if like one of my friends heard me talking to God and like was messing with me. And I'm like, there's no one here. And I look at, and I open up the passage. It's just like literally it opens to a passage. Mm-hmm. And I open it up. I read it. It's about this Taoist master connecting the energy of his lower Dan Tien to his students and leading them across this raging river. And you know, basically showing them how if you connect your mind with your energy, you could be super grounded and not, you know, die in that scenario. And I go, what the hell is this? So I look at the cover. It says The Wandering Taoist. And I'm like, okay. I check out the book. I read it that night. Next day, you know, a testament to how old I am, I open up the yellow pages and find a kung fu school called the Taoist Institute. Mm-hmm. In North Hollywood, not very close UCLA where I was going to school, but close enough. I walk in there. I grabbed a buddy of mine because, you know, at this point I'm like, hey, dude, you want to do kung fu with me? And he's like, sure. So we go in there and, you know, the master comes across the entire studio into kind of the waiting room, like just basically walks past my buddy and goes straight up to me and goes, oh, welcome. I've been expecting you. And, you know, slip, right? And that was it, right? I was just like, what? And so I started studying Kung Fu, Tai Chi, Qigong. Turns out he was the elder disciple of a number of different Kung Fu masters. He'd studied with the best of the best of them, including the kind of highest, most illustrious Taoist abbot that escaped from China and came here, and then the highest, kind of most illustrious Buddhist teacher that came over. And so he was the lineage holder of all this crazy stuff. I started studying with them and then, you know, kind of met the grandmaster and, you know, I was already kind of shaving my head at the time, so it didn't make too much difference to just call myself a monk. You know, I took the vows and became a Taoist monk, and studied with the grandmaster and studied with, you know, these just really interesting, amazing people ever since. It changed my stars that day, you know, radically transformed, you know, the path I was on and put me on a path that's been, you know, I never look back. It's been incredible.
I wonder if it changed your stars or if it was in your stars all along.
Well, that's it. Well, so the stars are the stars probably, right? But who you think you are is this facade or this narrative that you need to bolster until you have enough ego strength to release all that and, mm-hmm. and really, you know, get a chance to get to know who you really are. And so, yeah, I mean, this was always my destiny. I mean, the dude walks up, he's like, oh, you're back. You know what I mean? And so it's like, okay, this is so much bigger than me. Like, okay, what do you got? And he had a lot.
Was it hard to let go of everything else?
Well, my parents didn't like it. You know, immigrant family came over here, busted their ass, get their son, you know, to study hard and, you know, make it. And so now, like, Dr. Boy wants to be, you know, hippie voodoo witch doctor guy. And so that was a bit of a challenge because, you know, I respect them and I love them and I honor them and thank them for all the work that they did to get me to that point. I just couldn't walk that path. And so, you know, like any good parents, they just want the best for you. So that was kind of the hardest part. I mean, for me, it was, this is what I'm doing, right? Like, I'm in. But to kind of translate that conviction and that level of kind of energy and momentum that I'm feeling from this internal pull now to people who just don't understand that and are like, you're throwing away your future, was, you know, a little bit of a translation issue. And, you know, it didn't matter. They saw in my eyes the conviction. They're like, wow, this kid found something. He's smart enough. Let him go, you know.
Woohoo!
Yeah, exactly. And just, so you just go.
The name of the book again that you found that dropped was?
The Wandering Taoist by Deng Ming Dao.
So The Wandering Taoist and talking about following our paths, you ended up, it sounds like, overseas in a sense, becoming a wandering Taoist.
Yeah, and that's part of the algorithm, right? Is, you know, you stick to your life here, you stay put, and you're around the guys you grew up with and the people you're around and the culture that, you know, kind of reinforces your identity. It's really hard to see things differently, right? You're a product of your environment. You fall into that mold. And so, you know, then I was still studying at UCLA. I didn't, you know, my commitment to my folks at the time was, look, I'm not going to drop out of school. I'm going to study, you know, I'm going to study history. I'm going to study politics. I'm going to study things. I want to learn, mm-hmm. right? I'm a student of life, but every quarter I would just study really hard. And then I would take either a quarter off or every time I'd have a summer or something, I'd just go on sabbatical. And so I had the, you know, the distinct privilege of being able to sit with the Karmapa Lama, the Dalai Lama, multiple gurus in India, you know, a lot of phonies and a lot of amazing people, right? There's a lot of people selling spirituality, as a commodity. There's a lot of people trying to, you know, run all, you know, energy through themselves. There's a lot of distraction and a lot of, kind of disillusionment out there. But there's also people who are there and they live there and they embody what they're representing, and they get out of the way so you can find your own connection with it, right? And so, you know, it's kind of wild, wild west out there in the East. And you know, you get a lot of people who splash up on the beach of these ashrams and these temples who are just running away from the world. And, you know, when I realized that phenomenon was happening, you know, it just started to feel kind of decadent and self-indulgent to stay there, mm-hmm. because I really wasn't, you know, I felt like I was, it's frankly, it's kind of easy to be enlightened in the Himalayas. You just, you know, you just sit around and meditate all day and do practices and it's pretty out and it's nice. Try coming back to Los Angeles, California and helping people who don't give a shit. And finding a way to have them see what you're even talking about, and, you know, having bills and mortgage and all the different things that make up a householder life, and then pressure test what you do against that, right? It's much harder to live in this world and be balanced than run away from this world.
How did you do that? We have a I guess I can call him a friend over in Thailand who he ended up staying in the equivalent of a cave in Spain for many years, where they'd give him food and then he would do his practice in this tiny little cubicle, basically, and be there 24/7. And it seemed challenging for him to make the transition back from that into this other world. How was it for you going from the mountains of the Himalayas and transitioning back into Western life?
Kind of like the space shuttle has these really special tiles that are kind of put on the outside of it so it doesn't burn on reentry. Mm-hmm. I didn't have that, you know, so I lost my hair. It was interesting. I went back kind of as a commitment to my folks, but also as just kind of a really good wraparound to the knowledge that I was getting. Was I became a doctor of oriental medicine. Mm-hmm. So they still got a doctor out of me. But it was integrated with my Kung Fu, my Tai Chi, all of those lineages are tied in. And so the medicine is part of it. And so in doing so, I came back and started a practice as a healer, which is a nice way of being able to kind of interface with society and reality. Because, you know, people come to you once they're already breaking. So obviously something they're doing ain't right. It was fine, except it wasn't big enough. Mm-hmm. Because I saw the world sliding faster than I was fixing it. And so I then thought that the solution set to that problem was to integrate East and West. And so in my 20s, really, I got a couple medical doctors. I started a medical group. We grew it to 3 practices. I had Dick Butkus as my spokesperson. We're just, you know, we're just working and working and working, seeing, you know, hundreds of thousands of patients. But I wasn't happy because, A, the people coming in needed a diagnosis code, which means things already broke and I was trying to fix it after, you know, the demolition derby. And B, I was inside of an insidious model with a third party payer system where, you know, you're just, you know, I'm in my 20s. I got, you know, I think $180,000 a month in overhead. And, you know, not a business background and just hustling, trying to get people who owe us money to pay us money so we could help people. And it just got to the point where I realized that the business of medicine, mm-hmm. is just, it's out of control. It's top down, corrupt. And so, I was in that model. That was, you know, that's how I ate, was, you know, in that model. And I realized I had to get out of that model. But in doing so, you know, I took a lot of bullets and took a lot of stress and really got an opportunity to pressure test what I knew from my monastic training days and, you know, kind of put that through the filter of extreme stress and being around unethical people and all sorts of things that come your way when you're in the business world, and really reconcile, you know, who I am and what I'm doing with, you know, what my outside world looks like. And so that was really my reentry pain. It was, you know, 2 years of very aggressive kind of calculus, trying to figure out how to maintain, you know, an ethical base in a really disturbing industry. And then I realized you don't actually have to stand in the ring because you will get punched in the face. So I started swimming upstream and doing corporate wellness and things that help people not need me. And that's how I ended up in media and books and movies and all things that I do now. Was I realized that I was trapped in a mental construct, and that mental construct was my prison. And I thought that, well, because this is the way things are done, that I must do them this way. And it was just depleting my vitality, and I wasn't really in my strength. And so a lot of, you know, the work I've been doing in the past couple of decades really has been around exorcising toxic memes, yeah, and beliefs that keep us constrained. I mean, you know, energy, we all have energy, but we're so inefficient at where it goes because of our self-definition and our contracts with the world. And you got to really look at those things to understand where you're limiting your power and your flow. Like, I was just stuck in this crappy corner of the universe trying to do my best to, like, you know, lift up a couple, you know, pillars. And instead now I'm, you know, literally transforming things on a global basis with our next movie and involved with some of the most inspiring people in the world. And it was just about getting out of my own way.
What became your mission at the time? And was it very clear? Because so many people listening to the show, they're hearing you, they're hearing their story, they're feeling stuck, they feel there's something more, but they don't know how to figure out how to get on path or on purpose.
Right. If you would have asked me the day I decided to give away, you know, my stake in the medical group and just kind of walk away from, you know, good money and a future, security, all that kind of crap, you know, where if I was going to be able to stand in the place I am now with what I'm doing, and did I see that clearly? The answer is hell no. It was just about taking that one step and mm-hmm. stepping in the right direction, and then following the breadcrumbs and kind of the guidance of the universe, and just doing what's right, and just keep doing what's right and what serves your heart. So it was just a very interesting road, and I just, you know, kind of as opportunities came, I would kind of pass them through the filter of my heart and my consciousness, and I just kept doing the right thing. And, you know, it built on itself, but it wasn't like, oh, okay, I have some sort of crazy master plan. I'm a hard worker. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're a hard worker, you're going to be fine. But you just have to decide to move in a direction, and then the entire universe will conspire to help you do so. But it has to be a decision you make first.
That makes perfect sense. You talk about in your book about kids making maybe a decision too early of having to declare who they are, where it's better if you just step out and at least be moving. And you talk a lot about moving and energy moving. So you decided to get the flow going again.
That's it. And, you know, still water breeds poison. And so, you know, if I'm stuck in a place where I'm like banging my head against the wall trying to make the world work mm-hmm. and it's not working, then, you know, it's not the world's fault. Right. It's, you know, I need to think differently. And so I just moved out and got into the flow of my power. And it was just, you know, the answer is usually think bigger. Right. And you're trying to take care of a global problem, one patient at a time. You're missing the corrupt, disgusting, you know, kind of system mm-hmm. that is kind of a cabal between Frito-Lay's and Pfizer, if you will. That is creating an environment where people stay sick and the system is, you know, and the middlemen and the insurance companies make all the money. And it was just this thing that I was stuck in. It's just a dark eddy in the corner of the flow of the universe. And so, you know, either you stay there in a parasitic model, or you just rethink it and show other people that that's not health. That's not even healthcare reform. It's healthcare finance reform is what they're talking about. You want to reform healthcare? Do Tai Chi, you know, eat vegetables. Like there are a lot of ways to find health, and it's usually not through your insurance carrier.
That makes sense. We're going to dive into that some more. We're going to dive into your book, but there was a comment, and I want to find out about your movie in a second, but there was a comment you made that was so powerful that you talk about in the early chapters of the book, where you're under stress. You didn't say go small and go hide on the couch or under the desk. You said think bigger.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, well, that's it. You know, my friend Srini, who's a neuroscientist over in Harvard, says, you know, neurons perform the best on the edge of chaos, right? And so you want to get to the point where you want to innovate. It starts to trigger epigenetically. It starts to trigger your survival genes. And so either you're going to like crawl under the rock and like, you know, collect your welfare check, mm-hmm. or you're going to stand for what you believe in and be, you know, be the warrior, right? So I just, you know, I'm a geek. I think of like Aragorn in Lord of the Rings or something, right? Yeah. You just got to draw your sword. And oh, what are you afraid of dying? You've done that before. Just stand up, right? And so, you know, for me, it was really about doing all this training and then falling into the hypnotic trance of like how the world works. And this is, you know, now listen to me, kid. It's great that you did all this like, you know, hippie shit in the hills. But now let me tell you how things are done, you know, here on the Death Star. And it was just like, okay, sorry. You know, I was so idealistic. And then you forget that you had a vision, you had a glimpse of that which is real and true. And that most people are walking around like hungry ghosts and are lost, following models that are, you know, parasitic and really kind of induce a form of slavery. So what, you know, the question is, what the hell are we doing collectively? And so, you know, am I going to fall into that mold, or am I going to stand and be an independent thinker? And you know, what this world needs is more independent thinkers. That's it. And the challenge of training independent thinkers is you start doing that, and then they get to the point where they turn to you and say, okay, now what do I do? And you're like, oh, man, whoops, this is deep, right? Mm-hmm. Right? This is deep. Like, this is still – you're still asking me questions that you should be asking of yourself. So it's just, you know, we've all had a lot of cultural brainwashing, and it's taken us into a place where, you know, we pollute the planet and shoot at each other and all sorts of things that are probably uncool to most people. But you know, we just accept them as the way things are. So the question is, why are things that way, and what can I do about it, right? And so again, I fundamentally challenge all my students to really think through all of those assumptions and be like, well, why are you too small to do anything about it, right? The guys who signed the Declaration of Independence in this country knew that their lives were on the line, but they stood for something, right? What are you going to stand for?
Yeah, people don't realize that if it didn't go their way, they were dead.
Their heads were on that ink, right? And so, but like that's the move. Like, you know, what bridge are you willing to burn to stand up for your conviction? And then you don't just like click your heels like Dorothy and like, you know, just end up there. The literal translation of Kung Fu is hard work, and you just kind of work your ass off. Like, you know, the people I know who are successful work towards what they're working towards pretty much with every decision, with all their conviction.
Would you say though, when you are, because a lot of people again listening are saying, I'm exhausted, I don't know how to do that because I don't know where to find the energy. But once right. you get it flowing, once you step into the hard work and make that decision, kind of putting your head on that platter, you start to get energized by the process.
That's it. Well, and plus, I mean, if you look at the energy economics of our lives, mm-hmm. the real question is there really a true lack of energy? Mm-hmm. Or are you needing to look at your energy expenditures and see where you're leaking it, right? In what psycho-spiritual emotional facets, in, you know, your Facebook tendencies, in your, you know, TV shows that are your must watch, in sitting at a desk and like collecting dust and turning into, you know, a blob versus getting up and standing up and moving. And so, you know, what I started doing is I realized that, you know, being a physician for thousands of people in LA and, you know, just, I've been around that block. And so what I started doing is giving people swaps for what they're already doing and changing little micro behaviors, little micro habits. Mm-hmm. I mean, like, all right, instead of this, let's try this. Oh, you feel better? Great. Now, instead of taking that energy and blowing it, let's invest it in, you know, taking a walk with the dogs an extra time a day. Oh, great. That makes you feel better. Cool. Let's try this. And so just kind of eking out some efficiency and like really kind of getting some profit out of each of those like departments in your life and then reinvesting that. And then, you know, it doesn't happen overnight. And I think that's like the problem. I think a lot of the hypnotic trance we're in the West is like, you know, the Godfather whacking people all week and going to the Pope to ask for forgiveness, right? And it's just like, oh, sweet, I'm absolved. This week I'll go do it again. And that's, you know, the kind of the savior mentality of kind of early Christianity, I think, has been misinterpreted. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we all think that, you know, there's going to be like some guru, some pill, some Amazonian vine that I just don't know about that's going to basically like transform everything. All of a sudden everything's going to be cool. No, it's just, start changing your behavior, and every day, you know, things get a little better. And, you know, a year from now, you won't recognize yourself, right? Time is on your side if you start acting now.
And that's a huge thing that people don't get. It's something that we're always talking about. I'm always talking about on the show, which is, and I can't claim credit to the quote, and I'm going to butcher it anyway, which is we completely overestimate what we can do in a day and completely underestimate what we can do in a year.
That's great. That's a great quote. And that's really appropriate because we make all these things. So it's like you'll sit there and be like, okay, let's make a list of everything that's wrong with my life and everything that I need to change. And then, okay, so today I'm going to be a vegan and I'm going to start qigong and I'm going to start climbing rocks and all. It's just an unrealistic. So it's about managing expectations, mm-hmm. and understanding that you cannot build an Eiffel Tower in a day. But if you really wanted to build an Eiffel Tower, you can get it done, you know, in 20 years. And so just looking out across the horizon, of time and using time as your ally instead of this thing that's just like, you know, kind of stalking you and, you know, you're going to try to do too many things in too little time. It's just a recipe for disaster. And so for me, with my students, we do these things in 100-day spurts called a gong.
Yeah.
And so for every gong, you just pick, you know, a couple behaviors you want to change. You start doing those every day and you look at your 30, 60 and 100-day goals. And it's like, you know, I do a lot of backcountry backpacking. I do a lot of stuff out in the wilderness. And so when you're doing map and compass and when you're trying to like set your trajectory, you get your waypoints and you're mm-hmm. like, all right, look, I'm going to get to that hill over there. And then from that vista, I'm going to kind of see how I want to approach the lake. Right. And so, but people will be like, I got this 5-year plan and I'm going to be a multi-gazillionaire and I visualize my vision board and all this stuff that is really like cute, but I think incomplete. Because it takes out the actual effort and the work and the planning and the day-to-day behavior changes that'll help you get there. So then you get there 5 years from now, you look back and you're like, oh shit, I just found this old vision board. I'm such a loser. I didn't do any of that. Or, you know, I tried. And so what you do is you start proving to yourself that you're a failure instead of having little micro wins, proving to yourself that you are a winner and you can do this every day. Right. And so you don't start with 45-pound curls. You start with 5-pounders if that's where your first workout is. That's just reality. And most people aren't being sold reality because the internet, TV, all this, you know, kind of marketing messaging is really about selling a promise of something that's unrealistic. And people have come to expect and believe that. Right. And so, you know, again, that's part of the trance, part of the zombification of humanity that we all need to kind of fight against.
Yeah. I like, though, when you start with the small micro steps. So you get out there, instead of having the 5-year plan, you're going to head for that hill. There's a phrase that always comes back to me that I work when I'm coaching, which is, or something better, which is you have a vision or something better. If I take small steps, I start with those 5-pound curls, maybe I'll find I don't like the weights, but I've started working into things. Maybe I'll go do kung fu. So I've mm-hmm. opened myself up by taking those steps.
That's it. And that's all it really takes is to pattern interrupt the dreary sleep that we've all kind of slipped into and then start getting these little wins. And again, you're like, oh, wow, I did that. That wasn't that hard, right? Mm-hmm. And so most people think that they're going to go from zero to hero. It's like, okay, I've been sitting around watching Game of Thrones all season on the sofa ordering in pizza. So I'm going to go call the local CrossFit gym and I'm going to look like that dude in like 3 months. And, you know, you end up popping the labrum in your shoulder, you know, straining your hamstring, all sorts of things, because that weekend warrior mentality is, again, the same thing. It's like, you know, forgive me, Father, for I've sinned. Now make me a 6-pack. Right. And it doesn't really work that way. You know, the 6-pack is really, you know, what accompanies the pizza on the sofa after your injury. Mm-hmm. And so I don't see that working. I've never seen that work. I work with the best doctors in the world. I've sat, with the Dalai Lama. And, you know, I just fundamentally take an oppositional stance to the way this marketing messaging works, because it's all a distraction. And what really works is what we know works, which is, you know, a daily hygiene that just moves you in the right direction.
So if a student comes to you and they say, I want to change my life, this, I've had enough of this, I'm starting to wake up, the gig is over, how do they begin, or what are some early baby steps they can take?
Yeah, great. So one of the things that I've found is incredibly relevant to this process is mind-body practice, because it's one thing to say, okay, you're going to get up and do 10 push-ups every day, and you're going to, you know, bring that up by 5 reps a week, and cute. And then once you get distracted, you move on to the next thing, because, you know, most people work out to the point where they get to where their goal is, and then they just go back to like eating how they did. And so everything's a yo-yo. Everything is a distraction. Everything is about spurts that we fall asleep from. And so I love teaching qigong, tai chi, meditation, mind-body practices that really help illuminate this part of the brain and wake us up so that we actually have access to the prefrontal cortex and negation of impulses and all things that actually help us get through this journey, right? Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, it's, you know, it's one thing to say, okay, I'm going to build a practice. It's another thing to build a mind-body practice that then is really part of this kind of contract you have with the universe to say, oh, this is the time of day where I'm supposed to pay attention to what I'm doing. And as you start, that becomes like a beachhead. And as you start developing an awareness of what you're doing, and you start to really gain a little bit of clarity on who you are in relation to the spinning, you know, orbit of you know, particles and things that you call your life, then you have a frame of reference that you can come back to. And then you really take that skill and build it into the operating system of how you run your life and how you run your day. Mm-hmm. Then the magic starts to happen, right? What seems like magic, right, is actually you sitting back in the driver's seat of this thing called life and understanding that some of it is about, you know, you making decisions, and a lot of it is about you getting the hell out of the way, because the person making the decisions this whole time was the person you think you ought to be instead of who you truly are. So it becomes this kind of dual trajectory of figuring out who you are while using the world as your workshop. And it just then, that's what, you know, in the ancient scripture is called revelation, right? It's like then, you know, God or the universe is revealing himself to you in every moment, and you are in an opportunity to constantly learn about yourself and get out of your way and get into the flow of grace and all the abundance, the infinite abundance of energy that's all around. We don't let it in based on who we think we are.
What's fascinating about what you said is, I mean, there are a lot of really cool aspects, but one thing that I heard is to start to wake up to all of this, step back into your body, get back into the vessel so that you can see the whole world around you, so that you're not completely disconnected from it.
That's it. And it's the opposite orientation that has afflicted humanity. I think the spiritual crisis that we're in as a culture is there's no meaning, there's no purpose, there's really no direction other than the direction that we're being told top down. And so people have been trained to look outside themselves for answers, whether it's for diet, whether it's for spirituality or financial advice and all this stuff. And like, you know what? My body tells me it doesn't like cheese, right? I know when I'm full. I probably, you know, already heard that vegetables are good for me, but I'm still like, you know, reading some sort of like Vogue magazine tabloid to be told what to do by some like, you know, impossibly skinny expert who's on, you know, ephedrine. And so, you know, and you look at this, and I'm not being flippant and disrespectful, you know, mindlessly. I know a lot of the health gurus out there, they say, eat the way I eat and you're going to look like me. But what they don't say is that I slather testosterone all over and take hormone shots and blah, 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 blah to look this way, right? And so there's a lot of facade. There's a lot of BS out there. And at the end of the day, you know, whoever taught you to trust yourself, whoever taught you to find that inner voice and really feel how you feel about something. And so we look outside of ourselves. And that, to me, is kind of one of the fundamental flaws of how our culture has been oriented. And so, you know, real men drive big trucks or Maseratis, you know, an attractive woman has this purse. And that's all in the messaging that makes us not feel good about ourselves.
You call that a mental virus.
Yeah, a meme, a mental virus that has been embedded. And that's how advertising works, right? Like I don't need a new car. So, you know, someone's got to get in my head and say, you know what? a guy like you, the CEO of well.org, you're a filmmaker, you're this, you're that, just keep putting feathers in my cap and be like, a guy like you needs to drive this kind of car, right? Because then you get, you know, all the kind of cultural feedback that goes with that and all this. And, you know, if I'm in a weak moment and, you know, I'm feeling insecure about myself and whatever, I might bite. And I'll think that the way I feel is because, you know, I'm not getting enough respect or accolades in this culture. I better go get that Maserati so I could, you know, hang out with those big boys. And you know, it's just one example in one stupid corner of the universe, but it happens everywhere, whether it's, you know, in children's clothing all the way through.
How do we go from there and instead get the mirror so that we start to put it on ourselves? And how do we start to dive inwards?
Yeah, it starts with meditation. And so this is the challenge, is the answer is simple, and our culture, because we're so complicated, we mm-hmm. think that we need a complex solution set to our complex problems. But what if simplicity was the solution for complexity? And so, like, you know, I'll be like, hey, you should meditate. And people are like, yeah, I've heard that shit. What else you got? You're like, well, have you tried meditating yet? Well, yeah, I tried it. It was hard. I'm gonna stand right here and wait, right? And so that's the thing. It's like everyone's trying to sell sugar cereal to kids and put toys in it. And the answer it's been for 6,000 years, but because, like, the internet exists, we think that there's some different answer. And we're just constantly searching for something new because we don't want to do what's hard, mm-hmm. which is stop time, check in with ourselves, and learn who we are and ask the more important questions. The answers are everywhere. I mean, the internet has, you know, a gajillion answers. What's much more relevant than answers today is better questions. And so asking the question, who am I, is much more important than trying to, you know, decide who you are, right? And so these disciplines have these embedded in there. And my challenge is, I'm holding the line. I don't care. You know, I don't care. I'm not doing this to get rich. I'm not doing this to get famous. I don't care about any of that stuff. But what I do care about is a lot of people within these traditions mm-hmm. have started to kind of popularize and modernize it in a way where they then break the line. And then they're like, oh, okay, well, yeah, you could just do this here and this there, and kind of disassemble the fabric of how the practice is supposed to kind of mm-hmm. cohesively hold you. So then you create a generation of looky-loos where nothing really works for them. So you might as well just take a quaalude, right? You know what I mean? Like, if you're just going to not do things the way they're supposed to be done, and you're confused about why meditation didn't work for you, then you just didn't find meditation. You weren't taught it in the right way. You didn't do qigong. You didn't do these practices in the right way. And someone was trying to sell you a shortcut. I am the anti-shortcut guy, right? I'm not going to try to take people's money, sell them BS.
Well, it seems like in going back to what you were saying a few minutes ago, and you said internet versus 6,000 years ago, internet really is all about what's up here, what's above my neck, all in my head. Give me more intellect. Feed me. Junk food. When we need to drop out of this guy up here, we need to drop into what's here, what's real, sure. What's true.
And do we even know how to search that, right? Like, we all know how to use Google, but mm-hmm. how many of us know how to search the feeling in our heart and step into how we feel right now and realize that, you know, what Susie said walking out of the lunchroom is still sitting with us, and that's making us feel like, you know, a certain way and making us kind of move towards a decision that isn't going to really serve us or our families. Mm-hmm. And so these types of things, you don't Google. You Google inward, right? And so there are a number of traditions. I'm not like one of these guys that's like, you know, it's all about the Pedram show. There's a number of traditions that are wonderful. Pick a tradition, right? Pick something that works and has a tried and true lineage that, you know, allows you to kind of stand where you are mm-hmm. and dig until you hit water, instead of poking around trying to find water across 20 acres and just sitting there exhausted, right? And so there are a number of tried and true religions. There's a wonderful array of, you know, as much as there are, you know, kind of crappy BS, you know, fake teachers out there, there's plenty of really good, honorable people that are doing the right work. And they're willing and able to teach, and they're usually not the ones standing up there tap dancing saying, look at me. And that's the challenge. That's a challenge with this whole damn thing. Like, I don't want to do any of this stuff because my practice is private. I was making movies about health. I was making, you know, movies about environmentalism and trying to help the world with, you know, kind of changing the messaging. And I got pulled into this arena because I was just so tired of seeing people faking it and people, you know, diluting the message and trapping people in something where they think is good for them, and it ends up just being a waste of time. You know, time is all we've got. If you waste your time, you've wasted your life.
Let's talk about time. Then I want to talk about what your latest movie is. You talked about a few minutes ago, no time. We need to tap into no time. What is no time?
It's the space at the end of your next inhale and at the end of your following exhale. If you understand how to couple your consciousness with your awareness mm-hmm. of your breath and what's happening inside your body, you find that place of no time. And in that stillness, in that really amazing, powerful space, there is no compression. There is this incredible sense of vitality and spaciousness where the walls aren't caving in and you can make decisions outside of duress. And you come to your higher self, and then suddenly you start cultivating this thing called consciousness, which is really just this tether between you and the universal mind. You start really, you start getting a glimpse of who you really are and how you connected with something so much bigger that it's unfathomable. And so you stop BSing yourself. You stop making up scripts and narratives of who you think you ought to be and all this crap, because you're tied to an intelligence that's just flowing through you. It's not like you get annihilated, but the parts of you that are just disruptive and in the way and cause inertia, those are the parts that fall away. And what's left is just beauty, the beauty that you recognize in others and others recognize in you. And it really starts to kind of cultivate this bonfire of love that then you have for your fellow man and woman. It's really powerful. And I don't want to, you know, people are like, oh, that sounds so flowery. I'm like, it only sounds flowery because you haven't tried it. The reason the language is the way it is from everyone who kind of taps into that is because there's a unifying experience that we could all corroborate and agree on that, like, mm-hmm. yo, hey, yeah, that's there. I felt that. You feel that? Hey, right? That's cool. Right? And it becomes a part of a reality that you can no longer deny and exist. It's much more real than all the stuff we see getting tweeted around in the blogosphere, right? Mm-hmm. And once you're real, then you start to breathe and move from that space of true reality, and then you're in your body, you're embodied, you're alive, and people can see it in you.
You're living an authentic life.
That's it. And your authenticity shines, and everything that gets between you and your authenticity becomes your life lessons. And the sooner you kind of learn to move through and let go, I mean, they talk about these metaphors of alchemy, turning lead to gold. It wasn't about, you know, boiling down Smurfs. It was about finding the lead of your human existence and transmuting that into gold, which is, you know, basically there's no impedance in that metal. And so the flow of the entire universe is moving through you, and you're not obstructing it with your limited self-definition and your doubts and your beliefs that get in the way of that.
Woohoo!
Woohoo!
So what is the new movie that you're working on? What's your mission you're on with it?
So I started my first film about health. It was really kind of a response to the healthcare system and why it doesn't work. And then I moved into kind of following the breadcrumbs and saying, oh, well, it's interesting that, you know, we're not healthy because there's something new happening. And we really explored the chemical industrial industry and all the mm-hmm. stuff that's getting put into the environment that are poisoning us and making us feel less healthy. And so, you know, you got to know about that. And then as I kept following the breadcrumbs. Again, I never thought I'd be making a movie about the economy, right? I was a Taoist doctor guy. And so I started following the breadcrumbs, and I realized, oh my goodness, it's really where we spend our money and where we reallocate our wealth, which determines who has the power in this world. And so I've spent the last year and a half going to all the, you know, top conscious capital companies, interviewing their CEOs and really kind of researching and looking at what they're doing that's radically transforming the landscape of the world, and realize that, look, if we can understand our personal role as a stakeholder and understand that every time we put our money anywhere, it's a vote, and we're giving allocating power to whoever these people are, then, you know, we are responsible for the ethics of the people that we're betting on. And if we're not happy with the outcome of how the world looks, then why are we spending our money with the guys that are buying the lobbyists that are transforming the world into what we're unhappy about? And so there's a personal role, there's a personal accountability, and there's an incredible amount of power that comes from this. And so I don't want to get too far into it because there's some really big kind of things we're doing with the movie.
Yeah.
It comes out in August, but suffice it to say, I'm not playing small on this one because I've got two young kids at home and they deserve better. You know, their dad needs to step into his highest expression and do what he can to deliver them a world that's safer, healthier, less toxic, and, you know, just more loving. And so am I going to wait for someone else to fix the world? Because that's been going on for several generations. I don't see it happening. Or am I going to step up? And what the hell difference am I? How different am I than anyone else who's listening to this? And the answer is nothing separates us. So every one of us has to step up.
So when somebody says, and this is a big, not a big argument that I make, but it's one that drives me nuts. When somebody says, I can't make a difference. First off, I tell them to dive into themselves because that's the biggest way that they're going to make a difference. And what you're saying is once you do that, we all not only can make a difference, we have a right and an obligation to.
100%. I mean, I'll start with just even like the most minute little example is like, okay, well, I go to Starbucks every morning and, you know, buy this. And so, you know, so Starbucks may have some ethical things and they're considered a conscious company, but, you know, there's a lot of supply chain stuff and things in between. What if you found a coffee bean that comes directly from a shade grown operation that supports the local people and grows back the canopy and ends up costing the same, if not less, because you're now brewing coffee at home. And you've changed a little ritual there. Now you're supporting this supply chain of people that are actually, you know, thriving, cutting out some of the middlemen and doing something that's a sustainable practice. And then you just go all the way up from there, right? You have an electric car. Okay, well, can you ride your bike more often? You can't make a difference. You have product A and product B. Product B uses, you know, child labor and discriminates against women and offshores their tax dollars. Product A is trying to do the right thing. They might even cost 25 cents more. Take less, right? There's every single one of us with every penny we spend. I mean, do you bank at, you know, big bad bank that is, you know, stealing money and proving to us that they're unethical at every turn? Or can you go to a local credit union that takes your money and then reinvests it back into local economy and helps, you know, your neighbors thrive too? And so that's so there's not a single person that this message from this movie can't help. And we've made it very clear that there's no place to run, no place to hide. Every single thing you do, whether you're, you know, allocating food stamps all the way to, like, you know, investing your money, or where you work, makes a difference. And so I'm not buying that. I'm not buying that argument. Every single one of us contributes to an economy, and every single interaction you have with the economy is a vote.
Amen. What would my wife, she's the producer, she always likes me to ask a question as we start to get toward the end here. For parents and their kids, what have you been teaching your kids about the world today and to empower them as they move forward?
Well, I live in Southern California, you know, except for last week, we don't really have much water. And so it just doesn't make sense to have a lawn. So we tore out our lawn. We put in raised beds with a sprinkler system. I ended up taking, you know, putting a whole house chlorine filter and getting some of the, like, soil consultants. I have the best, like, soils, like, ecology I could create inside my garden. It's all about the soil, right? And so I've had, you know, some of the best consultants. I mean, being the CEO of well.org, I get to, you know, hang out with smart people. And so I've had all these people come through and help me kind of think through my garden and all that. My one-year-old, my two-and-a-half-year-old, and I walk out every morning, pick kale, spinach, you know, anything that's you know, harvesting right now, mints, whatever. This morning we put in Swiss chard. We put in snap peas. We pick it all right out of the garden. We go in, we make a green smoothie, and we have a compost bin that we take some of the other stuff out, and so we put in the compost. We do all of it, and, you know, it's the baseline of our ecology and our economy happening in my suburban backyard. And this is what they're learning from ground up, right? I want them to see, you know, Daddy not just talking this stuff, but we all practice what we preach. And, you know, there's a lot of things that we could be doing with our time. There's a lot of ways we could be spending our money. Like, we boycotted presents now for the holidays and mm-hmm. birthdays. They get one toy every, you know, holiday, and the rest of it goes to their college fund. And, you know, I don't need containers full of plastic crap being made by, you know, people who are not being treated well in China to come over and fill my house and you know, serve my children in some way. I would rather take them hiking, right? And so I spend as much time as I can with them. You know, we're going skiing next week. And that's really it, is, you know, there's life, and then there's this kind of sad replacement for life, which is a narrative and, you know, stories and characters and Disney movies and all this kind of stuff that's kind of infiltrated the minds of our children. And, you know, Daddy's got to stop that.
I love that you brought it right home and brought it right to the earth and brought it right to the soil and the natural world. And I'm sure when they can, you've got them going barefoot in the soil and their hands in the soil as well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. My wife comes from the school of thought that it's like, oh, my God, it's dirty. And, you know, I'm just like, dude, this is the best thing you can. Like, front of the house, shoes mm-hmm. don't touch people's tires, right?
Yeah.
Back of the house in the backyard, you can do whatever you want, right? And they're just, I don't care if they put it in their mouth. I don't care about anything like that, right? Like, let their ecology be boosted by their ability to, you know, touch the earth and be barefoot and all of it. Yeah, absolutely. It's great.
Woohoo!
Woohoo.
So from there, a few quick wrap-up questions, then we'll jump into a brief meditation. First off, what personally brings you the greatest happiness, or what I call the woohoo factor?
You know, at this point, before kids, it was backcountry backpacking. Mm-hmm. Now it's taking my kids into those types of environments and exposing them to all those things that I valued and loved so much. It exponentially magnifies the joy that I have for those things, watching that kind of experience and that kind of connection with that level of reality download into a young consciousness and see them kind of like wake up and come to life through it. It's magic.
Beautiful. I've got to ask, because kids are on the radar for my wife and myself, and then the next year or two here, at least that's the path we believe we're on. How much hiking have you been able to do with the 1 year old?
Yeah, mostly like, you know, holding them in the little thingy casey thingy, right? But you get to somewhere and then you just let them stumble around, right? And so, you know, there's nothing like a meadow with just everything that's natural, and, you know, whatever they find is, you know, okay to put in their mouth, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And you just let them explore the way a child 10,000 years ago would have, which is, this isn't like, oh, I'm out on a hike. They're in the garden. They never left the garden, right? The nature is always permeating. It's everywhere. It's their home. And so, you know, we've gotten to this place where like nature is dirty and, you know, the synthetic carpet is home. And so they're naturally inclined to unfold into the full expression of who they are, who we are, who we're supposed to be. Just let them go in nature.
Woohoo!
Woohoo!
So, any last words of wisdom you want to share before we jump into a meditation?
The answer comes from within. Look, you could find teachers that'll help guide you along the way. That's fine. But at the end of the day, if you understand that the orientation has to be around the light of awareness, turning back inwards to observe the self and observe the universe through your internal universe, and then out, what you'll start to learn about is how the world outside of us is just a reflection of our inner state. And your life will look that way. But then if you start watching the news and watching kind of the collective unfoldment, you'll see where people are at. And mm-hmm. it's just a fragmented consciousness based on a misunderstanding of who we are spiritually. And so the answer to that isn't, you know, I mean, yeah, it's nice to go do marches and you know, be, you know, political advocacy and all this kind of stuff. But really the answer is tap in, find yourself, heal yourself from within, and the world around you starts to rapidly improve. So this orientation of trying to fix things outside of ourselves is really part of the problem. Fix things inside yourself and you'll see the entire universe conspire to bring order and beauty around you.
I couldn't agree more. I love the mission you're on. I love the work you're doing. I support you 1,000-fold. Where can people go to find your beautiful book, to find out more, to find your retreat coming up, anything, everything of yours?
Sure. Theurbanmonk.com. Mm-hmm. Easy enough. So that's where I do all my kind of personal development work. And then well.org is where I'm the CEO, and we do a lot of our movies and our projects there. So theurbanmonk.com and well.org.
Fantastic. Do you have a short meditation you'd feel called to share with us?
Sure. Let's close our eyes. Unless we're driving. Have the tip of your tongue touch the roof of your mouth. Start breathing in nose and out nose down to your lower abdomen. As if you have a balloon down there. Just inflate it on the inhale and deflate it on the exhale. Just take a couple breaths here. Anchoring and settling our mind. Again, the tip of the tongue touches the roof of the mouth. Slow, rhythmic breathing. Once we've anchored the mind, you could spend 5-10 minutes doing this on your own practice. For instruction purposes, we'll move on. On the next inhale, I want you to pull white light in from every cell, every pore of your skin, every cell of your body. Inhale, bring it all the way in, deep, deep, deep to the deepest layers of your body, into your bone marrow, from your toes all the way up to your head, into your brain. Just breathe, 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 breathe. Pull in the white light on the inhale until you're completely full. And on the exhale, simply release and shine out like a light bulb in all directions to infinity. You breathe in through every cell of your body into the core of your being. And then simply ignite the light bulb and shine out in all directions on your exhale. Put a smile on your face. Do this for one more cycle. We'll come back to our bodies after that. So really feel it. And just return your breathing back to your lower abdomen just so you can kind of ground down when you're down. You could do this anywhere. You could even do it with your eyes open, standing in line at the bank. Just constantly allowing light and energy to cleanse your system and then shine it back out. It's a really good energy hygiene practice in a world so filled with yucky, mucky, crazy. You want to turn your light bulb on and brighten it as often as you can. Anything that gets in the way of that shine, shine the light of your awareness on it. See where you're stuck. See if there's parts of your body where you can't feel this happening. And keep breathing through and shining light through and just let it go. Let it go. We have this insistence on attaching to things that we associate with who we are and our past and all this stuff. Just shine it through, let it go, let it dissolve. Allow some of the things that you've been holding on to just move along. You could thank them for what they were there for. You could thank them for their service to you. But you don't need that to define you. As a matter of fact, you don't need anything to define you. To make definite is to bring out of the infinite. So if you really want to find your eternal nature, don't try to define anything. Just keep asking bigger questions. and tapping into that light, exploring who you are within the context of that eternal flame. That's where the good stuff happens. Bring your breath back to your lower abdomen. And you can slowly come back into the room and know that you could do this practice anywhere. It's yours. I might have shared it with you, but I didn't do it for you. So I'm nobody in this equation. This is your work, and this is your path. Take it and run with it, please. Feels good, doesn't it?
Woohoo! You are the most beautiful nobody in the equation, my brother.
You know, proud to be a nobody. Really, somebody's getting their own way. I don't care to be a somebody. None of us should. You know what? Nobodies move everybody and everything through them. And so, you know, be an empty vessel. Don't take yourself so seriously, and just commit to growth. Commit to waking up. Commit to loving your neighbors and loving yourself. I mean, it's not, it's always been the message. It's just, you know, again, the message gets distorted and commercialized and stuff, right? None of that's necessary.
Woohoo! Thank you, thank you, thank you, Pedram. This has been a true honor and a joy. I can't thank you enough, and for the work that you're doing. Crank it back up for the finish here for everyone out there. This is Michael Sandler saying be well, have fun, get the urban monk, and take that journey on the inside and shine bright. Woohoo! Yes! Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. It was great. Really, really nice interview. Very great energy. I appreciate you.
And I as well. Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed it, be sure to like below. Also, leave your comments. Have some real fun with it. Subscribe to our channel where you're going to get more great videos, more interviews coming up. And check out our website, inspirenationshow.com. That's where you'll find tips, blogs, information, videos you won't find anywhere else, and useful and helpful resources to really help you kickstart your life and to shine bright. Thanks so much again. Thank you for your support. Like, comment, subscribe, see the website. Thanks so much, and have fun. Of course, shine bright. Woohoo!